Right, kunaka kwenzimbo kakunoto kuona kana waenda pa nzimbo ya chona. Haugone kutawora nzimbo ya usina kuyenda. That is why Nasita decided, you know, let's go to Kariba. Timbo noona kunaka kwe Kariba. You know, most of the times, tinoita zwe kuona mabuku, we normally see pama pictures. But today we've decided, as same TV crew, we've decided to come to Kariba so that we can see what is going on, what is here. You know, most of these things, you know, Kariba, it is a holiday resort which is rich in our, which is rich with our history. But anyway, so today we just want to talk to a lady who knows more about this city of this town. It's a town, this town of Kariba, this majestic town of Kariba. So come and see the Chichiriko Kunoko. I mean, I'm sorry, the market of book must Babuins, must Babuins, I'm in a problem. Okay. Right, she doesn't tell them where Zimbabwe never come by me, so I'm not saying TV, Nasi Nakamira, Nakamira, no, and I'm not going to do it. All right, Zimbabwe, get up to Zogoti, Munzani, we find out about you in the party.
You need to meet one, Nyasha, Muzibwa. I'm going to find out in the office in the Kariba Public Center Association.
Okay.
And it's a membership organization which was formed as a trust with the municipality of Kariba being the founder member of the association and got in partnership with stakeholders around the town with the mandate of marketing the town for the purpose of increasing traffic to our resort town. So as a publicist in our office, we have a collection of pictures that I will show you around, which explain the construction of the demo and other activities that are happening currently. Saying that you are also well informed about our town in Kariba.
Okay, so meaning that we will get a lot of activities which took place in the past, also which are taking part currently here in Kariba in this office. Okay, so this is what we are going to do. We are going to give the whole platform so that she can show us what happened. She can tell us about our history and where we are currently. So the floor is yours, Nyasha.
Right, thank you. Okay, we will start with the background of how the Kariba Dam was constructed. So the construction started in 1956, you can see in these pictures. And when they were constructing the demo, since it was along the Zambezi River, they would create what is called a coffer dam. On a certain area, they would be concentrating on the wall. So I don't know if you manage to zoom in so that the viewers might see what I'm talking of. These are the oval walls that were constructed for the purpose of creating dry ground, so that they also don't disturb the flow of Zambezi River as it was flowing. And after completing the construction of a certain part, they would dismantle that part and move to the next. As you can see, they had reached the cave of the wall. They had to build another one. But in this instance, they had also built some tunnels by the sides of the mountains and the gorge, so that the water would manage to pass through. And like I said, the project was not meant to disturb the flow of the river. In 1958, this picture, I don't know if it is much clear for the viewers to see, this was a flood which was never anticipated
by the engineers of this project. It was said it was expected probably in 1,000 years, but one morning they wake up, the water flowing on top of the river. So there are stories to say where the wall stands right now is believed to have been near the womb of what we call the Nyaminyami, which we have yet, it's believed to be the river god of the Tonga people. So it's believed that the partner of the Nyaminyami had gone downstream to bless other communities. And when it comes back, it finds this wall blocking its way home. It actually caused the havoc that in people's eyes, they would actually believe that it was a flood, but it was unbelievable because there were no rains that had happened to say would have caused the flood. So in this incident, about 86 people died, and they are recorded in a memorial church which was built by the Italians, which is in Heights area. There is a placard which has got all the names of the people, but unfortunately, the 86 people recorded were the Italians, there's no record of the black community which was taking who were working on the demo. So we safely say the number could have been more than 100, since the black communities or our grandfathers were populating, were having the large number of the workforce on the project. So another incident which happened is it's believed that with the storytelling, some bodies couldn't be found on this incident, and they had to consult the traditional leaders. They made a sacrifice by killing a bull, and the blood was sprinkled on top of water. And the next morning, the bodies were found floating on top of the water, and they were taken for burial. This actually showed that even the project, the people never wanted the project to happen because it disturbed their way of living. And you see this house, it's a house in a low density area called Heights suburb. It's the same cement which was used to build these houses, is the same cement which was used to build the wall. It was strong enough that once applied, it dries instantly. So we hear some stories that if one of the workforce or of the, especially the black community, the black workers would fall from a higher ground and would drop in one of these pits, no one had the time to pull you out of that. So you'll be buried there and there. Plus that, I don't know how true is that, but some of those stories. We also have this picture showing the official opening of the demo, where the Queen, Queen Elizabeth, was the guest of honor, accompanied by Prime Minister Roy Velensky. She is shaking hands with the Zimbabwean chief called Chief Samba Karuma, and this is the Zambian chief standing by the side. We share. Zambia occupies 45%, Zimbabwe occupies 55%, and the Queen is not the one who just died a few months ago. This one was the mother, but the one who died it was now, it actually been ascended to be the Queen, but she was nursing one of her firstborn, the baby, and I'm not sure if it's the king now, King Charles. So she came representing him. So this one was the mother. And moving to this, some of these pictures are for the celebrations on the day, the ones you see here. And this is an article which was written in honor of the official opening. So we move to that side. We have what is called Operation Noah, this was an initiative which was led by this guy called Rupert Fothergill. There's an island which was also named after him, which is in the lake. I think if you have seen the social media or the safari lodge which was built recently on the island. And when the project was being planned, they had a plan to say the people will be relocated to such and such areas. But for the animals, they were quite forgotten. Such that when the volume that you see today started building up, the animals started to get stranded. Some would drown, you can see in these pictures. Some would also die. We actually lost a number. And Rupert Fothergill, with the assistance of all these people you see in these pictures, these were volunteers. No one was paid to do this work. They managed to run this campaign of rescuing these animals. And most of them were relocated to Matusalona National Park. And a monument was built in honor of this work, which was done, called the Operation Noah Monument, officially opened by Ian Douglas Smith in the picture. And in total, when you visit this monument, I hope you manage to do so, you will find there's a list of all the animals that were rescued by that time, and they amounted to 4,855. But we safely say 5,000. Why? Because after the erection of this monument, they later they continued the campaign up until 1963-1964. So they would do this work using different means. They would use some nets. You know animals have got this thought that if a human being is coming or is near me, the only thing he or she wants was to kill me. So they would use nets, pitch from one end to another, and chase them towards that direction, and they are captured in the nets, and then they are relocated to Matusalona National Park. The bigger ones, they would use rafts which would float on top of water, and some, the dangerous ones, they would use tranquilizers so that they are manageable to work with. You see, this is a black mamba being extracted from a tree, a porcupine in that picture. So all this work was in honor of the of preserving the wildlife that we see today, that also is also the backbone of the tourism industry in our town. We move to this side where you see pictures of the Tonga culture. So we preserve these pictures in celebrating or preserving their culture. Since this was the tribe which was mainly populating the Zambezi River, or the area that you see the dam standing on. Though there are other tribes, other people from the Shangwe, and by then there were no demarcations that we see today. Even the Zambians, they were also occupying the area. So this is a baobab tree. They would build their homesteads near or around a baobab tree, because this baobab tree represents long life. It's one kind of a tree that can survive for generations, for centuries. If you manage to have encountered that 10 cents we used to have way back, when you're coming from Makuti, just 20 kilometers before Makuti, when you're going to Harare, or after Makuti when you're coming here, it's by your right. That's the baobab tree that's on the 10 cents. So you see this area, even going the Churundu way, there's much population of those kind of trees. These are Tonga girls you see here. And the skirt which they are wearing is that one. I hope you have time to capture that. They would also wear these necklaces to differentiate that this one is married and this one is not married. And for women who were ripe for marriage, they would pluck the two front teeth as a sign to say this one is married. So you see most of if you have time to go and revisit Ja Fraser's song Dangani Chiringa, you will see there are a lot of those people. Or he captured from Binga, that video. You see those ladies, the old grandmas, they have gaps here. And you also see they also have these. This is their way of beautifying themselves, the seashells, the bush logs. And this is called the Chikwepa. It was used by women over 40 years to smoke marijuana bange, and from the visitors that we have been receiving here, they say it's quite similar to the shisha. We have one here, though it's not here, no longer in the proper shape it's supposed to be. So we are told they put grain here. And then probably millet, chibage, or any kind of grain available would be put here. They form a ball out of powdered mbanje, put it here and put another layer here. So this container will be having charcoal. So charcoal will be put here on top of whatever has been put here. And it will burn everything here. The smoke will come down using this pipe, and here there will be water. So it will be safe for them to smoke using this side. And it was just a process of purifying all the bad elements that would actually affect the lungs. We also have, let me finish here. These are musical instruments. We in Shona we call them magagada. This is a mode of mbira. This is a mode of cheka. And what do you call it? Chino chingita
bute
kibako mkoka dagger storage. This one and chai swani pass, and then chino so. So this is just someone who kept it to resemble the original one. And we also have the cooking pots that we have in our Shona cultures, the chirongate, ajgana, tambakozi, and the baskets. We also have hunting tools. So with these arrows, they would actually create poison out of herbs from the forest and apply on the tips of these arrows. So when they strike an animal, the poison will actually weaken the body of whether it's an elephant or what, so that it's easy to catch. We have this, when you see them, they are sort of like rocks or stones. This is a mopani tree, which you can actually even put in fire side that you use it for cooking or what. So what happened is when the water started creating the volume it has today, no trees were cut down. It was just water covering everything that was once on dry land. And with the mopani tree, when it's in water for more than 40 years, it turns into a stone like this. I hope my brother you might try to lift it. Your ammonia enough to do so. So it is actually turned into a stone like a fossil. So it goes under a process called petrification. If you manage to have a boat cruise along the lake, you might see these as rocks. I think this one also, you might see this one is just a rock lying there, but it's a mopane tree which is going under the process of petrification. We also have this type, these are models of the boats that you find in our town. This is a carpenter, and it's such that it has got lights here just to identify each other. There's another boat, like any vehicle. So if you come in Kariba when it's night, you might think there's a town in the lake, and there'll be another light here. So the carpenter is attracted by light, so it will populate around that any kind of light that will be much brighter in a certain area. So after they realize that the population is actually improved, they will drop down this light to the bottom of the net, say that the carpenter will follow, and they are trapped in this net, and they will draw the net using this kind of, there will be two men, other one here. So it's quite a heavy job for one to do. And this alasi wanare fish, it's a tory fish, but it's a fish of its own. And for us, this one came from Tanzania, and it was introduced into the lake. It said it came in two buckets, and one bucket reached Kariba, and it was introduced into the lake, which has breeded in such a manner that it has become the beacon of industry in Kariba, where we are the largest suppliers of carpenter in the town. So also, it's a form of industry for the local people to sustain their families. This is a canoe boat, a model of a canoe boat. This is also a model of a houseboat, the one which these two are sitting on. So due to space, we just had to put them in one place. We move to this side. We've got this type of fish called the tiger fish. It's one type of fish which has created an event in the town called the Kariba Invitation Tiger Fish Tournament, which happens every year in October. So it's one great puller for the foreign market of tourists. So we also have a project going on. Yes, it's actually the real tiger, which was molded with chemicals, so that it stands like as it is, as it was in road. As you can see, there were people who are now tampering with the trying to pluck off the flesh there. So this work is done by what are called the taxidermists. If you have seen in films or of those white people, white farmers, they'll be having sort of like a trophy of the head of a lion, of a kudu, of a, so it's actually the real animal. So we can go outside and we explain the project going on. I'm not sure if I can start with this, so that you might see. This is just an illustration from Zambezi River Authority.